he's still at home, I guess. As far as I know. He mailed.
Pastor Jimmy?
Yeah. Okay, there's another, we're just gonna be more in prayer. Heavenly Father, we know that all of us need you all the time, but sometimes we need you more than usual. So we lift up all of those who are going through difficult times. Heavenly Father, we just pray that you'll put your arms around them and you will let them feel your love and your presence. And we just pray that you will bring good from the bad. And Heavenly Father, we especially go with those that have been mentioned tonight. We ask that you will go to Susie and we pray that her procedure goes well tomorrow and that it does what it needs to do to make her better. We pray for Jean Harris and for Jeff Boggs as they are continuing to deal with their medical problems. Heavenly Father, we just ask that you will go with Pastor Jean. We just pray that he will improve. We pray that he will keep his family healthy. And Heavenly Father, just all the people that we have on our personal prayer list, we lift them up to you. And all the people that we have on our church's prayer list, we just lift them up to you. Heavenly Father, we just pray that everything will be done in accordance to your will and that you'll get the honor and the glory. And now, Heavenly Father, go with us as we delve into your scripture tonight. We're going to be looking at a lot of different verses. And we just pray, Heavenly Father, that they'll touch our hearts and that we will get something from them that will make us better Christians and be more faithful and loving to you. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Some of you, as I get into this, you're going to think, I've heard that before. And you have. I used it several years ago when Mark was here. I have added some stuff to it. I have taken some stuff away. I have changed it a little bit. But I thought that I would, rather than start fresh with something else, I would just go back to this and use it again because it is just as relevant now, maybe even more so than it was when I did it several years ago. It's part Bible study and it's part evangelism. And I hope that you'll get something from it that will touch your heart. We all like to hear good news, don't we? But unfortunately, we don't hear very much of it anymore. There's even a saying, bad news sells papers. People like to hear bad news. And I got so tired of hearing all bad news that I haven't read a newspaper and I haven't watched a news program since before the last presidential election. I didn't want to hear it. Everything I was hearing even made me angry or upset or depressed. Because think about it, when we turn on the television or the radio, what do we hear? Most of the time it's bad news. If we look at a newspaper or check the internet, what do we read? Bad news. The news is filled with stories of murders, rapes, robberies, kidnappings, shootings, tragic accidents, terrorist attacks, deadly destructive weather events, devastating wildfires. We've got one going on now, one of those in our mountains. War and civil unrest all around the world, abuse of all kinds, the spread of disease and sickness, COVID, and the arguments about whether or not you should be forced to take the vaccines, the usual political bickering and corruption, and we could go on and on and on and on. In our world today, can we find any good news? Yes, it's right here where it's always been, in the Bible, the Word of God. It's the good news of the gospel, and the word gospel actually means good news. But what exactly is that? Well, it's all about Jesus, his birth, his life, his death, his resurrection, his ascension, and his second Don't you love reading the Christmas story in Luke chapter 2? Don't you love singing the beautiful hymns, Away in the Manger, O Little Town of Bethlehem, Silent Night, Joy to the World, Mary, Did You Know? They all tell about the Incarnation, about the coming of God to the world in the form of man. Do you ever think how much Jesus gave up for us? He left His Father, whom He'd been with forever. He left all the glories and perfection of heaven and came to earth knowing what was in store for Him. He left the adoration and praise of all the heavenly beings. He came as a tiny, helpless baby who was dependent on Mary and Joseph for everything. Just think, He was there helping create the heavens and the earth and everything in them, but He had to wait for Mary to feed Him or to change Him. As a toddler, He fell and got bumps and cuts and bruises. He had to learn to walk and talk and do all the same things that all children must learn. As God, He had all power and He knew all things, but as human, He had to somehow hold back those godly attributes so He could be like us. And He did it all willingly because He loved us so very much. Makes me wonder how much we give up for Him. Sadly, not enough. Where is He on our list of priorities? Many times He's on down the line, isn't He? We put many things, even good things like family, before God. But what does the first commandment say? Thou shalt have no other gods before me. So when we put anything, whether family, work, pleasure, money, hobbies, stuff, before Him, He's not pleased. And how much of our time and money do we spend on the things of God? And how much do we spend on ourselves and our comfort and our pleasure? Jesus did something that no human has ever done. He lived a sinless life. And this is very important to us because if Jesus had committed even one sin, it would have been that sin that He died for. But because He never did anything wrong, it was our sins He died for. 1 Peter 2:22 tells us He committed no sin and no deceit was found in His mouth. And Hebrews tells us that Jesus was tempted in every way we are, yet without sin. How could Jesus live a sinless life? I don't know. I can't. I sin every day, usually several times a day. And every night I have to pray to God to forgive me for the wrong I did that day. And also for the right that I didn't do. Because like James tells us, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. And so many times I have good intentions, but I just never get them carried out. That makes me guilty of a sin of omission. And I need forgiveness for that over and over and over and over. One thing Jesus did to keep from sinning was that He communed with God the Father through prayer constantly. How many times do we read in the Scripture that Jesus went away by Himself to pray? By spending time with God, He was able to avoid sin. And Jesus told His disciples in Luke 22:40, pray that you will not fall into temptation. How many times do we sin simply because we don't pray enough? We need help fighting Satan. He is stronger than we are, but He is not stronger than God in us. Reading Scripture is also an aid to resisting temptation. David says in Psalms 119:11, I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. When Jesus faced Satan's temptations during the 40 days in the wilderness following His baptism, what did He do? He quoted Scripture. If Jesus needed it, Jesus.